Penguin Random House Audio presents Rethinking Diabetes, What Science Reveals About Diet, Insulin, and Successful Treatments by Gary Taubes. Read for you by Arthur Morey. To Sarah Halberg, for showing us how to live and helping change the world. The history of diabetes is marked by the recurrence of certain ideas which rise, decline, and disappear, only to make a new appearance and go through a similar cycle again in an altered form and a new generation. This is notably true of trends in diet. Roland Woodyatt, Roundtable Conference on Diabetes Mellitus, Dietary Trends, 1934. Diet has always generated passion, and passion in science is an infallible marker of lack of evidence. Lynn Sawyer and Edwin Gale, Diet, Delusion, and Diabetes, 2009. Introduction. The effect of any diet is to be judged by those who follow it, not by those who break it. Jocelyn's Diabetes Mellitus, 8th edition, 1946. Of all the chronic diseases that are likely to end our lives prematurely, none has been so intimately and surely linked to our diets as diabetes. Since its first unambiguous appearance in the medical literature, clearly diagnosed by Hindu physicians in the 6th century BCE, physicians have speculated on what aspects of our diet might cause diabetes and how it could be treated or cured by dietary modifications. By the mid-19th century, when the disease was still so rare that even the large urban hospitals of the era could go years without seeing a case, those few physicians who studied the disorder were identifying two mostly distinct variations. One was the form that appeared in middle age, and most often in those who also suffered from obesity. It appeared to be a problem of excessive formation, as George Harley of University College London suggested in his 1866 book on the subject. Later physicians would come to say it was a disease of overnutrition because of its intimate association with obesity. The far less common form struck acutely, most often in childhood or adolescence. These young patients died emaciated, as though starved for sustenance, often within weeks or months of their diagnosis. As Harley said, they appeared to suffer from defective assimilation of the food they ate. 20 years after Harley's book, the French physician Étienne Lancereau labeled these two diseases, clearly different in both their presentation and their expectation of future life, la diabète gras, fat, and maigre, thin or emaciated. Today, the technical terminology for the former is type 2, the chronic form that constitutes 90 to 95% of all diagnoses, and that we're likely to get as we get older and fatter. Type 1 is the form that appears acutely and most often in childhood and adolescence. Both diagnoses are characterized by elevated levels of blood sugar, blood glucose, technically. In the era before blood testing was commonly used, sugar in the urine was seen as the indicator of diabetes. Whatever the means of diagnosis, in both cases, the body is failing to properly metabolize the carbohydrates in the diet, the macronutrient that makes up the great bulk of the calories in grains, starches, and sugars, to use them for fuel as intended. For this reason, early diabetes specialists would often discuss the disorder as an intolerance for carbohydrates, or more simply, an intolerance for food itself. Until the discovery and purification of the hormone insulin in 1921, the first advice a doctor would likely give a newly diagnosed patient, occasionally the only advice that might confer any benefit, was what to eat and what not to eat to lessen the burden of the disease. A few of the 19th century physicians writing about the disease suggested that those with diabetes eat predominantly carbohydrate-rich foods, starchy vegetables and grains, sugar and potatoes, with the hope that their diabetic patients might compensate for their inability to metabolize these foods by consuming more of them. Most of the physicians of the era, however, took the opposite approach. since those with diabetes could not metabolize carbohydrate-rich foods but could metabolize fat, they told their patients that fat should make up the bulk of the diet. Patients were always urged to take more fat, wrote Elliot Jocelyn, who by the 1920s was the most renowned and influential diabetes specialist in the United States, if not the world. At one time, my patients put fat in their soup, their coffee, and matched their eggs with portions of fat of equal size. The carbohydrate was kept extraordinarily low. For a century now, diabetes textbooks and chapters on diabetes therapy and medical texts have invariably included some variation on the statement that diet is the cornerstone or the foundation of diabetes treatment. As I write this, the most recent guidelines from the American Diabetes Association refer to dieting as medical nutrition therapy, MNT. The word diet is now seen as connoting only a temporary way to eat, something you go on and then off, not continue for a lifetime. MNT is seen as integral to diabetes therapy. What constitutes MNT, the dietary recommendations themselves, has been driven over the decades not by any meaningful research comparing different dietary approaches, but by advances in pharmacological therapy for diabetes and new methods to deliver insulin, lower blood sugar, and monitor blood sugar. Patients suffering from diabetes are no longer instructed to avoid specific foods or food groups. Rather, they are expected to follow the same healthful eating pattern that government agencies and health organizations recommend for all of us: vegetables, fruits, legumes, dairy, lean sources of protein, nuts, seeds, and whole grains. Albeit with the expectation, if weight control is necessary, that they restrict their caloric intake. Controlling the symptoms and complications of the diabetes is left to insulin injections and a pharmacopoeia of drugs that work directly or indirectly to maintain blood sugar levels near enough normal that the specter of diabetic complications may be reduced. High blood pressure and the other complications that accompany the diabetic condition can also be controlled by medications. It is assumed that this approach is easiest on the patients, allowing them to balance the burden of having to inject themselves with insulin regularly, or wearing an insulin pump, or taking the necessary hypoglycemic blood sugar-lowering drugs against a greater enjoyment of the pleasures of the table and eating, much as their healthy non-diabetic friends and family do. In 2009, the British diabetes specialist Edwin Gale, writing with his dietitian colleague Lynn Sawyer, described this situation aptly as paying lip service to lifestyle change as a means of controlling diabetes. Life under communism, Sawyer and Gale wrote in an editorial in the journal Diabetologia, was once summed up in the wry comment that we pretend to work and they pretend to pay us. Our patients might equally complain that we pretend to offer a diet and they pretend to follow it. Sawyer and Gale, knowingly or unknowingly, were repeating what the New York City diabetes specialist Edward Tolstoy had written in 1950 when he explained his rationale for what were then called liberal carbohydrate diets or free diets. New patients would come into his clinic at New York Hospital, Tolstoy explained, and they would leave with very carefully calculated diet plans and a program of minimal insulin doses that would keep their urine free of sugar, a sign that their disease was seemingly under control. We learned quite frequently that a patient would leave the clinic after having been complimented on his excellent cooperation and would go at once to the hospital cafeteria for coffee and donuts or chocolate cake, and sometimes we found him enjoying an ice cream soda. We then looked the other way while saying to ourselves, oh well, his urine was sugar-free. Recent standard of care recommendations from the American Diabetes Association, the advice to physicians themselves, for instance, published in 2022 on what the organization calls lifestyle management, is completely in line with this thinking. Ironic as Sawyer and Gale, and even Tolstoy, may have meant it to be. The ADA suggests that because most individuals diagnosed with diabetes already eat a carbohydrate-rich diet little different from that of their healthy friends and relatives, then that's what physicians should recommend. The questionable logic being that if physicians tell their patients to keep eating what they've always eaten, the physicians can have confidence that their advice will be followed. For those who think that I am being unfair to you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.